posting in 5 and 4 seconds, 3 seconds. We will be live right now.
I guess you want me to talk now.
If you keep
talking. Hello, welcome to Life Through the Lens. Tonight we have with us Chip Litherland. Chip is an award-winning photographer with over a decade's experience in photojournalism and commercial photography. But that's not all. Oh, no. He is also a wedding photographer and a regular contributor to NPR, The Wall Street Journal, The New York Times, ESPN, The Magazine, and many more. And a little birdie told me that he is a color addict. I know, it's true. But Chip Litherland, welcome to your intervention. Just kidding. Or am I? Stay tuned. We will find out this and much more about Chip. Later also, we have our hangout, our after show, Afterglow, where we have our Life Plus One segment, and we get to share with you G Plus photographers that inspire us. And Chip, I believe tonight, is going to do that for us. We also have a On1 Perfect Photo Suite software to give away. Thank you, Brian Matias. Yay! Without further ado, my name is Kelly Sear Kim. I am a macro photographer and stay-at-home mom, and you can find my work here on G Plus or at kellyseagerkim.smugmug.com. And next up, we have Anna Nguyen.
Hi, everyone. I'm Anna Nguyen. I'm a photographer in Naples, Florida. You can find my work here on Google Plus now that I'm more actively posting, and also at dana.com.
Mr. Chip Litherland, how are you this evening?
I'm stupendous. How are you?
I am just great.
Awesome. Am I supposed to introduce myself right here?
You can, and then we'll come back to you.
My name is Chip Litherland. I'm based in Florida, down in Sarasota, in old people land. And basically, I'm a color addict, guilty as charged. So, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
We are very happy to have you, Ms. Karen Hutton.
Howdy, howdy, McDoody. Yes, that would be me, Karen Hutton. I have no idea why I just said howdy. I just wanted to share that came from somewhere that I have no knowledge of. And therefore will not be held responsible. I'm a photographer and a voiceover professional. I do the voice for Stuck on Earth. If you ever have that for the iPad, it's a fabulous app for travel. You can find me at KarenHutton.com for voice, KarenHuttonPhotography.com for photography. You can find my project of passion at LilGalleries.com, LILGalleries.com, where you will be entertained for a long time. And home is here on Google Plus. I'm really happy to be here tonight.
Yay! Keith Barrett. Hello, Mr. Keith Barrett. Thank you for recording and streaming this for us this evening.
Thank you for having me here. I'm Keith Barrett. I'm a computer tech guy with the Walt Disney Company, amateur photographer, and I host Vidcasts Hangouts broadcasts here on VidcastNetwork.com, and you can find me on Google Plus and KeithBarrett.com.
Right on. Ms. Carrie Murphy! Howdy!
Hey, everybody. I'm Carrie Murphy. I'm also a photographer. And you can find my work on CarrieMurphyPhotography.com. And my most recent work is always here on Google+. Thanks for joining us.
Hello, Mr. Ron Clifford.
Hello, Kelly Seeger Kim. Ron Clifford. You can find me at ronclifford.com. I'm an active member here on Google+, photographer who does weddings, events, and everything in nature that I could possibly find. I especially love macro work and really like the comments I get from Kelly Seeger Kim on macro.
I totally let you down this Monday, too. Sorry.
No, that's right.
Tamara Prusner, good evening.
Good evening.
That was pretty good. She totally committed to it. That's the beautiful thing of it.
Yeah, I totally committed. I'm Tamara Prusner. I'm a photographer in Arizona. I am currently working on Floral Friday, of course. I have my own website through tamseyes.com, and I am always most active here on G+. And I'm super excited about the show with the color addict himself, Chip.
Yay!
Whoa.
Welcome again. Yay. This is so awesome. I do have to say, before anything gets started, a little birdie told me that Chip called me the peppy one, and then I realized it gets worse, and then I was like, holy crapaloo, we are the seven dwarves. There's seven of us.
I don't want to know what I am.
Who's the dopey one? What are you trying to say?
That would be Anna. Anna's the dopey one.
Yeah. Jared is right next to
Tamara is the bitey one.
Yeah. The bitey one.
Come into my
I'll be bashful.
Good evening. And on that note.
On that note, Chip Litherland. Dude.
Hey, what up?
You have quite a background.
I do.
A really interesting blend, and I'm fascinated by the whole thing. We are all fascinated by the whole thing.
And that you make it work. Yeah.
What did you say?
Yeah. That he makes it work.
Right.
Yeah.
A
perfect blend of many forms. You're a photojournalist, and you're a commercial photographer, and you're a wedding photographer. How does all that work exactly for you?
Somewhat roughly, but it all comes together in the end. You know, it's a day in and day out process. You know, it's my background's fine art photography. Actually, I didn't go to school for journalism. Didn't even think about that as a career, and then basically one class at college changed everything and got into photojournalism, went going to little small town newspapers, working my way up to Dallas Morning News, then getting a job down here in Florida at the paper here in Sarasota, and I spent 8 years here as my first job, my only job, and then I basically decided to go freelance on my own, especially when newspapers started, you know, getting hit by all directions. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the newspaper world's been hit hard in the last couple of years, so it was time for me to go, time for me to explore, and now I'm doing everything, man. I'm, you know, weddings and photojournalism and commercial work, PR work, sports, my own little side project focused, and, you know, it's really a big mishmash of everything, but I'm just blessed that I'm able to make pictures every day still and get paid for it. So, you know, I really just try to keep myself not bored, you know, and that's the only way to do it is, you know, for me is I have no patience, and as a photographer, that really sucks, but I just spend all my time making pictures and learning this business and doing things like this that, you know, I try to be really active in the community and really enjoy and respect the fact that I'm able to do this as a career. So.
Well, a lot of people say that success in photography is all about figuring out what your genre is. Like, people focus on landscape, or they'll focus on portrait or whatever. But you've got it, you know, kind of passion and income streams from many different fronts. Mm-hmm. So are you an anomaly, or have you just sort of figured out the magic, you know, the key to the magic kingdom, or?
I
am wizard.
Yeah, it's true.
My wife's over here making funny faces at me.
I don't blame her. So.
Excellent.
No, I haven't. I don't have a magic key, but I have figured out things here and there that, you know, that work for me. But I don't know if I'm an anomaly per se, because there are a lot of us in this boat, just trying to figure out what to do with photography and how to survive. I mean, obviously the economy took a tank in the last couple of years, so. You know, diversification and making sure that, you know, my income isn't coming from one source of photography really kind of is what helped me survive and helped me succeed now. You know, some people say to, like, be totally, find a niche, you know, and really just stick to it. Mm-hmm. For me, I sort of have style and a vision, and then I let that go across all the different forms of photography. So, you know, I think most photographers, when they get laid off or they want to quit the newspaper world, they, you know, they're struggling. They don't know what to do. They don't know business. They're sent out into the world where all of a sudden, okay, it's all on me to make my career work. And so what am I going to do? And they usually go with what they know, and that's photojournalism and newspaper work. And that's one of the biggest mistakes I think that people make. You know, you can't survive on editorial alone. And I know that from experience, because I failed once and had to come back to newspapers. So, you know, it's been great. So I'm really happy to help people that are, you know, looking for the answer. And I don't have the answer, but I have some, you know, some sort of tips to get you to that answer.
You're the yellow brick road.
Yes.
Yes. Well, it's interesting.
I am the flying monkey. Yes.
You have a flying monkey.
Those guys really creeped me out when I was a kid.
You know, I have that toy. You know, the one you pull and you let go and it goes, whee!
Oh, we do too. God. The batteries got taken out.
Yeah.
Why?
Actually, Carrie is totally afraid of finishing the movie because of the flying monkeys.
Oh. I can believe it, totally.
Yeah. Well, Chip, it's interesting because my best mentor was actually my voice mentor, but she was the most amazing entrepreneur all of her life. And she always said, so she was my mentor, you know, in just about every way. But she always said, if you're going to be a successful entrepreneur, you know, with your own business, you have to have multiple streams of income, whether it's in the same industry or whatever. But the old notion, even, God, that was in the 80s, I think, she said, you know, the old notion of you grow up to do one thing, she said, is a thing of the past. And if people don't know it now, they will. And boy, we sure do now. So I think what you're doing is really, really smart. And I don't think, I don't know, I don't hear a lot of people, especially, I mean, you do editorial and,
right.
And you know, major hard news periodicals and outlets, and you do commercial for pretty high-end companies, and you do weddings, mm-hmm. and you're a color addict.
Yes.
I'm just trying to put it all together in my mind. I'm stuck on the color addict because I love color, too.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, it's so funny though, because I'm not sure if Chip, you even know this, but Chip guest speaks a lot to some classes, and you, like, every time you leave, everyone's like, I love Chip, I love Chip, I love
Chip. I had that effect, like, sorry.
Well, it's, wait, let's all do the Chip wave, ready?
I felt the wave coming on.
No, it's hilarious because my roommate's like, you know, Chip like followed her back on Instagram. She's like, oh my god, Chip, yeah! I was like, okay, do you realize that I like okay. But you're turning out to be a big deal. How do you feel about that?
I am nowhere near a big deal. I'm just trying to make do here in my little corner of the world, man. So, you know, I appreciate that. I love going to the classes down there, the one where we met, actually. It, you know, students, they go through school, and, you know, these teachers and these programs are, you know, they're teaching photography. They're teaching the basics of, you know, this is how you make a picture. This is shutter speed, and this is aperture, and this is, you know, what you do, and this is Photoshop, and all this stuff. But, you know, nobody ever gets taught business. Nobody ever gets taught, you know, what to do once you're out.
Exactly.
And so when I go to these things, like, you know, when I spoke at your class along way back when, I'm really kind of pushed, like, hey, you know what, this industry has its issues, and, you know, being a photographer is not glamorous. It can be, but it's not, and you got to really push it. I mean, you got to go out there, and it's all on you, you know, and I try to, you know, sort of reinforce the things about keeping your copyright and, you know, learning contracts and licensing, all this stuff that you need to know outside of just what it takes to compose a frame, you know? And so, I mean, I'm hopefully doing some good things in that respect by going to teach and kind of share. I'm
well, really you weren't technically freelance when you were in my class.
I was not, no.
You're not freelance. But you, I remember...
Go ahead.
You would like this. I remember when I make a frame, it's like... I think I'm like, if I Dutch a photo, I'm like, I better make sure that my horizon's crazy tilted, like Chip, or else he's gonna get me on my horizon. Like I watch my horizon lines now, because if I tilt a photo, I remember you saying, if you're gonna tilt a photo, you better tilt that photo.
Right, you gotta do it super purposely.
You gotta do it.
And there's even a way to do that, and you know, it's. You know, you're tilting a photo, but, you know, if you imagine, you got to have something over here to catch a photo, you know, if it's tilted this way, mm-hmm. there's got to be something here to root it, you know, and right. or else pictures just slide off the frame. So when you're breaking these rules, or when you're, you know, tilting frames and things I got yelled at for in school, you know, there is a little inherent little trips and ticks.
I was with you, tips.
Tips and tricks to make it work, and, you know, you know, every time you break a rule, there's another rule right behind it. So,
Go ahead, Tamara.
I was actually just going to bring back the business thing real quick, because I thought it was so interesting that you mentioned that when I've heard doctors say the same thing. They went to school to learn medicine, not how to become business people. Right. And it's something that it doesn't just affect our industry. It affects a lot of industries. And it's something you don't think about until you're stuck right in the middle of it.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
No, you're fine.
Interrupted and jerked us all off to the other side.
No, but you're right. But you're right. I mean,
you did a chip tilt.
I did. I was the tilt.
I think a lot of people are really interested in the chat about business. I really do.
Yeah,
well, I think it's daunting, really.
The thing about my situation was that, you know, I was at a newspaper that had 11 staff photographers, right? And in the matter of 2 years, we went down to four, you know, and those are all layoffs. And so, you know, most of these guys are not shooting anymore. Some of them are. Some of them pursued teaching, you know, different jobs, and some of them are just not even taking pictures anymore. I mean, that's how drastic it can be. Mm-hmm. You know, and a lot of photographers, in not only coming out of, you know, failed jobs, coming out of school and stuff like that, they're just thrown into a marketplace that is over. I mean, it's a funnel. I mean, this is what it's like in this business. It's everybody wants to be a photographer. Everybody thinks they're a photographer, and then it comes down to this little funnel. And then there's some people down in the little bottom that like spit out at the end, and it's tough to. I mean, you gotta lube yourself up and get squirt through. You know?
I'm so glad that the visual in my head just matched.
Sorry.
Let me write that down.
Yep. Oh, Chip, you have a huge fan in RC. Huge fan.
Yeah,
that was excellent.
RC just said in the chat that they love you at over at Kelby, because he said that. I asked him, what is it specifically that you love so much? And he said that it's often said that a picture needs three things: light, gesture, and color. He's extremely adept at mastering all of these things in a picture, but the clever use or lack of color.
Oh, well, that was nice. Thanks, RC.
Yeah. Well, so what do you mean by the three things? And I want to come back to business too, by the way. But I'm just so, because you know, here on G+, not all of us have known you, and we're like, where have you been? So we're like, we want to know business.
I've been hiding him.
All these things, but I'm so curious: light, gesture, and color. And if you need to use some of your work to demonstrate it. That would be fabulous.
Yeah, I can do that. You know, just basically before I do that, you know, it's those three things are important. And gesture, I sort of use that as body language or like moment. I don't really use the term gesture, but you know, I always, when I compose a frame, I always find the background first, or something, you know, light, or some sort of, you know, really important part of the picture. Whatever it is, whenever I walk into a room, whether it's a red wall or you know, stream of light, or you know, whatever that little element is that makes this scene really cool, I really try to abuse that thing and really, you know, focus on that, and then let everything else kind of fall into place. So, you know, light and color are obviously big for me, and in general, moments kind of come last. You know, I'm really, you know, really trying to find a frame that's aesthetically pleasing at one time, and also telling a story and delivering a moment in another. You know, the color and the light are just a vehicle for getting the story and a moment across to the viewer.
So that's what you mean. And RC did say that you didn't specifically say gesture, but that's kind of what you mean by, you could even call it like a brush stroke, or the I don't know, the thrust or the through line of the image. Yeah?
Right. Well, yeah, gesture can be anything. I mean, obviously, a moment can be anything. It could be as subtle as, you know, just a little flick of the hair, or you know, one little eye just kind of going off to the side. You know, things like that. But, yeah, color and light and composition and, you know, structure and geometry, you know, you would never think the geometry comes into photography so much, but, you know, I'm really anal, and that's really... It's a good... Yes, I've already said no.
I don't worry, I'm keeping track. I'm totally keeping track, by the way. I'll decide them later.
Sorry. Anyway, there's, you know, I'm really addicted to making my pictures perfect and straight, lines going like this, or, you know, when I have a diagonal line, it's got to go to the corner of my frame. You know, things like that really bug me. So I'm, you know, trying to find the perfect composition, but if there's not a good moment, it's kind of pointless. So, you know, it's kind of a marriage of all that. I can pull up some pictures if that helps.
Yeah, it does
help a lot.
We're all so visual.
Speaking of photos, yeah, Chip photographed me, like, what, 2-3 years ago, and I still haven't seen those images.
Oh, boy.
Uh-oh. Well, you're calling me out.
Live. She's calling you out live.
You can just send it to me, and I'll...
No problem. Yeah,
maybe he did you a little service by not sharing that.
I don't know. Chip has a method to his madness, because he was making me, like, do random things, and he's like, close your eyes, but like, do this and this. I'm like, I don't feel comfortable with this, but okay, you're the master.
Yeah, and in general, I'm not posing a lot of pictures. I mean, most of my work is unposed journalism, you know, and portraiture is the one thing that is tough for me, and it's not that I can't do it, but, you know, I don't necessarily like having control. You know, I like to be able to sort of, you know, let things happen and things fall into place.
Actually, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead, Anna.
The photos that are coming out of the class that you go and teach the workshop for,
yes.
Like, I can see, like, your use of light. I can, like, it's funny, like, when I see those images, I can actually hear you, like, talking in my head, going, you see the shaft of light here? If you just reduce this, you know, your shutter or your aperture, and you, like, in, I can, you spot meter, you can get this effect. And I'm like, I can hear that in my head, in Chip's voice. It's kind of creepy.
You're in her head, Chip.
I mean, you're
stopping your head.
So, Chip, open some of these up. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, this is my site, actually. I just, you know, it's just got redesigned. I'm, you know, sort of experimenting with this layout. And
that's chiplitherland.com, guys.
Yeah, and so if you see something when we're scrolling through or anything like that that you want to see, let me know. But, I mean, I'll just start with what pops out to me, but... is that picking up
awesome.
On the screen?
Yeah.
You guys are all good. You know, for me, the best times a day to shoot for me, I love noon light, which is really surprising. I really like noon because it's really harsh and you can get underneath balconies and use the shadows from there and stuff like that. But I really love twilight. It's like my favorite time to shoot. And it's just because the warm tones of the lights and the blue of the twilight obviously really make this really kind of cool contrast. So this is just a little puddle at a fair after a rainstorm, but
that's awesome.
For me, I'm less interested in really, you know, saying it all in one photo. I'm more interested in finding a vignette of life, and you know, just a little pocket of something that says, you know, it may not even, you know, be about the fair, but maybe it's just something a little bit deeper and a little bit more fun to look at.
Yeah.
This is going to be awkward when it goes back like that. But you know, a lot of the time I'm carrying my camera around just to, and this is a frame I made. It's, you know, most people want pictures of this or prints of this. And I made this while I was out with my daughters at a circus, you know. And
that's awesome.
You know, this is just the ceiling of a circus here in Sarasota. The Willinda's going on a high wire. So a lot of my work is graphic in nature, and by graphic I don't mean, you know, blurry, but it's more you know, shape and form and color and all these things that you would think you know, would come out of
did you composite those, you know, or was that all on the tent, just one single shot there?
All one single shot. None of these have been altered in Photoshop whatsoever. We, you know, beyond color enhancement and things like that. For photojournalism, I mean, a lot of your viewers may not be aware, but for PJ work, you can't tone anything crazy. You can't do HDR. You can't do any sort of removal of objects. I mean, what you see is what you get, and it's because of ethics at the paper. And, you know, you're really trying to, you know, let our readers know that we're telling the truth and you're representing life accurately. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean you can't have artistic expression and do these kind of things, but... It's something, the one thing that we have as photojournalists to hold on to and to to make sure that we retain it is really important to me. So most you'll see in commercial there might be a little bit of retouching because it's commercial work, but all this that I'm showing now is all photojournalism.
So can I ask, of the ones that you do, the photojournalism, the commercial, the sports, you know, the weddings, the portraiture, what is your favorite to do? Do you have a favorite?
You know, my heart's in photojournalism, but to me, you know, I sort of shoot how I shot at papers now in all different kinds of fields. You know, this weddings, I go and I shoot like I do for the paper. And
which means what exactly? How would you define what that is?
I would define it as, well, I call it color porn is what I call it. But you know,
of course you do.
I do. More innuendo for you.
Don't do that.
We really don't need to help you out with any of this, do we?
That last shot he just had is...
Really, you're loading it up for the after.
That last shot he just had was of my town where I live, that celebration.
Yeah.
Oh, the Mickey Mouse.
Electrical antenna.
I
was kind of curious to go a bit backwards into what you're talking about in composing your photographs, because you said you were a bit structured, or maybe even a lot structured, in that you like certain components to be a certain way in your images, yet at the same time, looking at this one, for instance, that Willendez and that other one of the Ferris wheel, they're very, really artistically captured. It's not an element of composition as much as it is an element of an immediate impression. Do you find you need to balance that or force yourself to be more artistic because you're so inclined to be structured?
I definitely push myself at every assignment and every gig, and the one thing I don't do is stray from my vision. I really don't want to present myself any other way for a client, because they're hiring me for my eye and they're hiring me for my point of view, and that I want to make sure I bring that to the table every time. And then again, I'm just not happy with pictures that you know that don't really fit in my vision or how I see the world. So I'm always constantly really trying to, you know, make pictures that fit that. But yeah, I mean, I'm forcing myself by exposure, by compositions through, you know, to really try to push the way something's been seen. Like, you know, at newspapers, you cover a lot of the same events over and over and over and over and over every year. And, you know, it was a great way for me to really challenge myself, as at every gig I would go and try to find something new about, you know, the place that I'm in.
Image? I know, it makes me want to just climb right in and look.
Wild.
Yeah, it's actually the full frame of the screen, but it's you know, it's on Siesta Key. It's, you know, just overexposed picture of on a cloudy day at the beach. I take liberties of, you know, with, you know, extreme compositions, extreme exposure, and I'm not really scared to, like, you know, mess up, you know, and that's, you know, the fear of messing up or doing wrong or proper exposure and, you know, I don't even know what light meters, whatever, you know, that kind of stuff. You know, I'm more about moment and more about just kind of feeling a frame and, you know, whether it's a little red building or, you know, the shine off, you know, muscular men. Here's your
Naisha woman.
I plus one.
There you go. So, you know, there's little things like that. And, you know, the other thing that you're not going to see in my work is strobe. In fact, that muscle guy is the only picture of you strobe on in here in my entire portfolio. I don't like it. I use strobes when I have to do commercial work, obviously, a lot. Mm-hmm. I'm more interested in natural light and how light just hits people and, you know, the things that we've done. So
will you show that plane?
Yeah, absolutely.
This is
in St. Martin. This is at the tail end of a wedding. That's the great thing about my wedding work, is that it actually takes me to places more than photojournalism did. You know, I'm going to a lot of destination weddings in the Bahamas and Barbados and all these, you know, St. Martin here and all these places that are, you know, really kind of fun to be in and to work in, but I always stay like an extra day and just wander around and make pictures for my travel portfolio, because I do travel photography, so, you know, this is, I shot this while I was drinking at a bar with a 50mm lens.
Wow.
And
it was really that low?
Yeah. It's that low.
Low enough to touch
the
wheel.
That's insane. Wow.
Yeah, you can go on YouTube and find all videos of these guys approaching, but the bar that I'm actually sitting at, they have the radio squawk at your tables. You can hear when a plane's coming in, and so you'll see all the beach people start getting out,
it's an attraction. They should probably start charging admission.
Yeah, it's wild. That bar is always packed, and you know it's fun. And these little slices of life are really what make me happy about being a photographer. But it's also these little things like I don't know if you can see my mouse, right? Like this girl down here with her arms out mimics the plane, and so there's these little relationships and pictures that I'm always trying to find, to make a frame work.
Yeah.
Let's see if I can scroll down. Again, like this overhang right here of this pool. I mean, that's at the tail end of a wedding in Miami.
Yeah.
That's the tail end of a wedding in Miami. And so that's from my hotel room, just straight down, boom. And the little surprises, like there's a woman here covered up
in her towel. Too much sun.
I did not see that. So, I try to incorporate humor when I can, and anything that surprises me, if there's something a little quirky about a scene, I'm really happy. So
we have a question in the chat that kind of ties into one of the things I'm curious about, your eye, and the question is from Carmelo. He says, I always seem to place my subject on the left and right of the frame. Is that a good practice to have? And I'm curious to know what your answer to that would be.
I use a lot of center weighted stuff. And, for me, I don't really pay attention to rule of thirds. Like, I know it. And obviously, this picture I have is like a perfect example of rule of thirds. For me, I think extreme right or left's work. And I'm more worried about how pictures play off of each other, like in my portfolio or in a story. And I find myself getting into little habits like that. And I'm always trying to make sure that I have enough variety, lens choice and, telephoto, macro, whatever it is, wide angle, to present to an editor. So when they're laying out a page, they have enough to work with. So I'm really conscious of that when I'm shooting now. But I mean, for me, there's no rules. I mean, there's rules, but obviously rules are made to be broken. And, if your thing is to, put Vaseline all over your lens and go crazy, then do it. If you're really into, the center weighted compositions, which a lot of my pictures are, then do it. And I don't think anybody should be able to tell you what's right or wrong with composition. It's just kind of how you feel. But you can see a lot of my pictures are dead center, boom, mm-hmm. boom, boom, mm-hmm. boom, boom. And
the other thing I've noticed about your pictures is there seems to be two dominant colors in all of them.
Yeah. Red is one and blue is the other.
So which one is your favorite?
Red by far. And it's my logo's red, and my blog's named after red. It's Red Lights and Red Eyes. So red is near and dear to my heart.
Yeah.
So
I remember you had said, if I had a bride that wore a red wedding dress, I'd shoot that wedding for free.
I would. And I put it out there on my wedding blog, hey, come find me. I'm going to hook you up. And I've yet to find one. So if you're out there and you're listening, let me know. I'll hook you up. Yeah. So,
Well, Chip. You can do the morning ceremony, which is the red dress.
You tell people, you teach people, and it's all about your point of view, and I always call it, your signature. People are always trying to figure out ways to distinguish themselves in the sea of photographers, and I'm always a believer that if you find your own point of view and signature, it's going to be as recognizable as your voice or your face or anything else. Mm-hmm. What kind of advice would you give people who are trying to find that for themselves and haven't quite identified it?
I'll put myself back on the screen for a second here. There I am.
Are you going to get serious?
You're not wearing any red.
No, I'm serious. I'm tired of looking at my own pictures. The question about, I'm sorry, your voice and... Can you repeat it?
It has to do with, you have a very distinctive style, And yeah. When you talk about it, you talk about that you have your point of view and you're not going to stray from that no matter what genre you're shooting in.
Right, exactly.
It's going to be an overlay of your point of view about that wedding or that event or that, you know, product, whatever it is that you're shooting. So I'm sort of going, I hear other people trying to figure out a way to distinguish themselves in the business, you know, right. Photography. And I have a really strong belief that it's about, I always call it signature, but it's your point of view.
Right.
So, but then the next thing is people say, well, how do I find that? How do I know if I have it? How do I know if it's valid?
It evolves naturally, man. That's a natural thing. That's not something you can choose. I mean, yeah, I guess you could choose to, I'm going to shoot with Polaroid film, 8x10. That's what I'm shooting with from now on. You know, that's my thing. And there are photographers out there that make their living off, you know, shooting right. just pictures from helicopters or, you know, doing, you know, black and white, you know, peel away Polaroid portraits and things like that. But I think it's a little bit more deeper than that. I think it's from the heart, from the eyes, from the mind. It's all these things that kind of come together the way you approach a picture. And I think over time it just evolves, and it's not like something that you can just choose, but I think it's something you can stick to once you find that. Like, this is what I do, finding my identity. This is, I know, I kind of know the way the pictures I like, and I know the way that I shoot, and so I identify with that, and I really try to shoot like that every time. And I think people out there are struggling to find it, and they're you know, not sure how to shoot or what to shoot, and they're trying to copy pictures or, you know, just doing what everybody else is doing. You know, I would recommend just kind of stop looking at stuff, you know. Go out there and just shoot, you know. Instead of taking all your lenses, grab a 50 in a body and just head out and start making pictures that you want to make, and not worrying about whether people are going to like them, or if you put them on Facebook, people are going to, you know, not like them or whatever. Like, what are you doing, you know? Just kind of be true to yourself, you know, and I think it just evolves.
That's probably a good thing.
Do you want me to pull more pictures? Or?
Well, I had a question along the same lines. You could pull more pictures if you can still talk.
Yeah. You don't need to see my face.
Actually, I actually, did you develop and scan some of the new focus photos?
I did.
Can we see that? And can you talk a little bit about your focus project?
You can't see the pictures because I've got some, you know, publications that have some rights to them.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay.
You can talk about this.
But I can talk about it, and I can pull it up. I've got the slide up right here, so I can pull it.
I'll give the link in the chat.
Yeah. So this is focusproject.org. It's kind of a reaction against, you know, the amount of imagery that's been coming out in the digital age. You know, it's been, there's so many pictures out there, Instagram, Hipstamatic, Facebook, all this kind of crap. You really, there's so much imagery out there, and it's hard to wade through sometimes. And, you know, some people just let technology kind of override thought and senses and, you know, just seeing, you know. And focus is a way, focus, for those that don't know, we're sending 5 cameras. You can see the kit right here on the screen. Manual film cameras, K1000, an FM2, an AE1, all with manual focus lenses and a one roll of film. And every photographer, there's 200 photographers, gets only one click of the shutter. And then the camera gets moved on to the next. These cameras go anywhere, everywhere from Libya to India to New York to Africa to all these amazing places, to all these amazing photojournalists, over 30 Pulitzer Prize winners. And for me, it's a little side project, but the whole idea was to slow down, you know, just take a breath and to rely more on, you know, seeing and having the patience to make one frame. And so it's kind of a challenge to what was to all my friends, and it just grew and grew and grew until, you know, some bigger names got on. And you know, now it's just, you know, something that I work on when I can outside of my own work. And it's not for me to make money. In fact, we're going to try to raise some money when this ends for some charities that are doing, you know, photo education for kids, you know, in lower income areas and things like that. Okay. So all the money, if we do make money in the end, will go to that. And I'm actually going to get kids from all these organizations to do a roll film. So it's going to be kind of a long-winded project because photographers are procrastinating and taking their sweet time with it.
So, well, we just have one photo. It's one photo, one chance.
Yeah.
You gotta ship it, though. You gotta ship the camera to someone.
It's just a long
process.
The other
part of it.
Yeah, so it takes a couple days to get there, then they hold on to it for a couple weeks, and then a couple days. So, it's going slowly, but, I've got about 30 or 40 pictures back, and they're great. I'm really excited to start sharing them.
I think it's really neat because I think with DSLRs, it's I think we get in the habit of I can take so many photos and then choose it later, and you'll see people in places and events and stuff just click, and I it makes me nervous to have too many photos to go through, so I try to shoot what I think I'm gonna like later because I don't want to have to sift, because that just I get all sweaty, it just bothers me. And this project really makes you think about what you're really, really seeing. What's important? What's the moment? What's the story?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
that's the thing is, we can get overwhelmed with just making pictures. It can be stressful, and technology can consume us. And that's the thing is, I could care less about gear. I could care less about cameras or lights or whatever it is. I have the cameras that work for me, and I just use them. And I use prime lenses, and I don't use any zooms, and I just if somebody, I'm shooting Nikon right now, somebody hands me Canon, I'm ready to rock. It doesn't really matter to me. And I think people get lost in technology and what chip is in their camera, how many frames per second. That stuff is unimportant if your pictures are terrible. It's just for me, and people need to let go of that. And focus on making pictures. And I'm not trying to say that to be rude or to be anything like that, but there's so much emphasis put on technology and so much money being dropped by students on camera gear and stuff like that. And in the end, got to be able to compose a frame,
Right.
So, but anyway, so continue. Sorry. My little rant is over. So
I think it's really good. I think whether you shoot film or digital, you really need to look through the lens and say, what's the story?
Right. Exactly. What are you trying to say? How are you seeing the world? That kind of thing. So.
If it was primarily about the number of frames you took that would develop your particular language, all of us should be virtual experts by now, because we have digital and we're shooting thousands of images.
I think
there's a lot to be said about not just the number of pictures you take, but the focus you put into the work you're doing.
That'd be a good exercise, Ron, for the mentorship program.
Now, Chip,
one image this week.
One image. Now, Chip, I know you probably don't take as many photos if you're on your commercial travel and when you're shooting for your commercial side. Now, weddings, do you shoot all the time during weddings, or do you, watch your frames? How do you go about that?
For weddings, I'm shooting in between, 3,000 and 4,000 pictures per wedding, and that's a lot, and it's because there's a lot more money involved, and there's somebody's, day is the most important day of their life is being involved. So, I'm not gonna miss a moment over some sort of archaic notion of, I'm gonna get the shot and be done. That's a whole different ball game. That's what I guess I should have said that. But, for weddings, I shoot a ton, but even when I approach weddings, I think I have my wedding site up here. When I shoot weddings, I'm shooting it the exact same way I would at a journalism gig. I'm using light and composition and all this kind of stuff to really, tell a story. And I don't stray from my vision even when it's wedding clients, because I don't necessarily want them to hire me if they want something completely traditional. So I always present myself as I shoot and what I do and how I see the world. So, it's all very, these pictures would work in my travel portfolio, I'm not really afraid to kind of break the mold of that as well. Let me see, click image, there we go. I'm doing underwater,
there's that tilt.
Yeah, there's a little tilt there. There's a little Dutch tilt in there. For that.
It's funny that you bring this photo up. It's been streaming all over Pinterest for months now.
Oh, really? I didn't know. I don't use it. I don't know. So. Are they crediting me at least?
Actually, it was funny because someone had said, "Who took this photo?" And like other random people were like, "Chip Litherland, Chip Litherland." I was like, "Yep."
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say the one thing with my wedding work, as you can see, it's under 11 Weddings Photography. That's my brand for my wedding work, and I keep it separate. I don't use my name because, you know, there's editors in New York for my other work that may not be into the wedding photography thing. And I realize that I don't want to, you know, stop doing everything. So I kind of keep my brand separate. It allows for growth in the wedding world, and then it also, you know, keeps my photojournalism separate because a bride may or may not be into, you know, how I shoot for other publications. So,
yeah.
But
I think that's a wise, just wise all around for you, because you're so diversified. It helps keep things compartmentalized, much like yourself.
Yeah, exactly. So, and also, you know, and but like I said earlier, all these pictures could be pulled in my normal portfolio and it would work. So
yeah, it still represents your style completely.
So I don't know. As far as, you know, mixing these styles and doing these kind of things, it all works for me, and I'm happy because every day I'm able to put on a different hat, whether it's, you know, hanging out with the bride all day or, you know, hanging out with the Heat, you know, in a locker room in Miami. Awesome. Is LeBron James and Dwayne Wade, you know, in an ice bath, you know, so
and they're texting
each other, or not each other, but they're that would be really awkward.
Dude, it's really cold here, isn't it?
Oh, yeah,
what is this dude taking his picture of? Yeah. I told you
it's cold.
There's so many captions you could put on this picture, but
I shot this for
ESPN and the magazine, and they did a story on one game, and it wasn't an important game, but it was a game, and you know, they covered it from all angles. There were 10 photographers, and I was in the locker room, so I had unrestricted access to bathrooms, to locker rooms, to everything, and you know, just making pictures and gaining trust of some really big superstars. You know, that's one thing. And you know, photography, you got to be able to be a people person. You got to be able to, and you know, approach a stranger, you know, and let them know that you just want to take their picture. So I really try to break out of my shyness when I have it, and doing, you know, things like this, like we're talking, you know, it might be out of my comfort zone, but, you know, it's all about being out there and being a people person, and nobody wants to hire a jerk, you know, and I just try to be a nice dude and be out there, and you got to be able to gain trust of people and become their best friend in, you know, 30 seconds.
I found a flaw in my business plan.
Being a jerk. Yeah. I have a question about color. I mean, clearly you have a perversion with oversaturated color.
Right.
Somebody said that. I believe it was you.
I am also a pervert. Yes.
Figured I'd toss that in the mix. So I'm curious. Have you always been so into the rich, oversaturated look, or has this progressed over time into
It's progressed over time. What's that?
So just like any addiction.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, it got worse and worse over time, and now I can't get away from it. I used to shoot a lot of black and white. I mean, and I learned in the darkroom. My father was a photographer, so you know, he wasn't a photographer by trade, just by, you know, hobby, but he was an Air Force pilot, and he would take pictures while he's flying, and my great-grandfather also did that. So I've always been around the darkroom, and I use black and white photography. And, you know, that evolved over time, and it evolved with my vision. But, you know, once I started seeing color and using it as a vehicle to deliver my pictures and to, you know, see the world, it kind of opened up my playbook. And to a point where, like, I still do black and white in my blog. There's black and white posts and things like that. But when I got my work re-edited for this rebrand, you know, she sort of took, and she being Amanda Sosa Stone, a great, great person, she just sort of said, go with what you do, and that's color, you know, and let's just abuse it. So every sort of genre you see in my work, even from the editorial to sport to commercial, all has this little, you know, little punch of color and this little, you know, use of color, and I'm happy with it right now. And I like the way I'm seeing, and, you know, I think people, you got to be happy with your work and how you're seeing the world, or you're just not going to, you know, ever progress or grow, you know, so.
Gary Monroe in the chat has a question,
and, yes.
And he says, what does Chip think about HDR? Always got to come out somewhere.
I hate it, to be honest, and it's not because I think it's bad technology or anything like that, but for me, it just kind of gets away from, you know, image making, and it for me, it just looks fake, and I can tell an HDR picture right off the bat, and I don't want to be distracted by technology, and I don't want to be distracted by, you know, a photographer's, you know, post-production in a picture. And that's just a personal choice. And, you know, I get it. You know, there's situations where you have to do it, landscape photography and things like that, where trying to make a sky retain and all that. You know, I like to let life be life. If, you know, if I have to silhouette a person to make a picture work, I'm going to do that. And I'm not going to do it in post and try to make it that person be rendered and the sky rendered. You know, I'm all about, you know, just natural, real pictures.
Do you think that ties in a lot with your photojournalistic roots, like that, to be true?
Yeah,
to
I was thinking.
Absolutely. I mean, that comes from, you know, me, you know, being raised as a photojournalist, or not raised, but being, you know, trained as a photojournalist and working in newspapers. It, you know, we had that beat into our head that we weren't allowed to do anything like that. That probably is rooted in that. But, you know, for me, I'm open to, obviously, new technologies. I'm all over Instagram, you know, that kind of stuff. But for my own work, I try to really just use available light and, you know, just kind of abuse what's out there and what's given to us, you know, by the photo gods of the world.
So. Oh, my goodness. Your action verbs are just out of control tonight.
Going back to business for just a second, you just said something that made me kind of go back to there, which is you're out there on many fronts, and people are always like, well, so how do I get out there? And you didn't used to do Instagram, but you do now. Mm-hmm. Like, what do you recommend that photographers who are trying to be more out there do in today's market?
You know, I'm a social media freak. You know, I'm out there all the time and on Twitter and Facebook and all that kind of, you know, Google Plus and all this stuff. But you know, for me, it's really easy to get lost in that world. For me, I try to do it all and just kind of put everything out there where I can. You know, I'm constantly doing social media. I'm constantly sending postcards out and, you know, you can cold call clients. If there's somebody you want to work with, pick up the phone. Nobody ever does that anymore. You know, you got to meet with editors. You got to go to workshops. If you're really young and just getting started, you know, go to some really great workshops. You know, MPPA puts on some great ones. You know, there's all the other ones that, you know, obviously we mentioned Kelby earlier. He's got some great workshops on his blog and stuff like that. You know, there are places to go meet people and meet editors. Also, things like the Photo Shelter blog. Photo Shelter is a great site, you know, for hosting your pictures and all that kind of good stuff. That's where I have my archive. They have great workbooks for, like, SEO, like how to bury keywords into your photography so that Google picks them up. If you're a wedding photographer, you got to be able to have, like, you know, Sarasota wedding photographer put into all your pictures so that Google finds those. So they have some great resources. You know, there's ASMP, a photo editor. All these amazing places to find tips and tricks about, you know, making your pictures be found. But moreover, I try to, every facet of my work, every site, even my Facebook, my Twitter pages, all that stuff all looks exactly the same. You know, I'll put screen share back on just so I can flip the room real quick. But perhaps. Can you see screen share now? Are we good?
Yeah.
Is it my pictures?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So, you know, here's my new site, right? You know, here's my photo shelter site. It same logo, same everything. It still has that same look. There's no confusion about who I am. Focus is a little different, so, you know, mm-hmm. we'll just get rid of that. But 11 Weddings, you know, the same kind of thing, same color, same all that. Same with, you know, the blogs match. There's not a lot of, you know, crazy jump from site to site. My blog, this is my Red Lights and Red Eyes blog. This is, you know, all very similar, same logo. My Instagram feed down here, you know, so I'm putting out a lot of visual chum, and that I use the word visual chum. If you're not into fishing, that's, you know, cutting up dead fish and throwing it out to where the sharks are to get them to start circling. And I do that with my pictures, you know, and I do that with, you know, how I market myself. I throw out a ton of visual chum. And I'm just hoping, like, one bites, and I'm trying to figure out what lure works or what fish works or whatever it is.
That's a great analogy.
You know, so it's those kind of things that I'm constantly doing day in and day out. And, you know, I'm freelance, so I have to get up and force myself to not play Xbox, you know, and not hang out with my poor kids, you know. you got to go to school. You got to get out of here because I got to work. So, you know, I got to work a 9-to-5 shift every day, and sometimes I got to stay up till 3 in the morning working pictures or finding a new way to find clients. So it's a constant battle, and there's so many ways to do it and so many ways that, you know, you can sort of put yourself out. It can cost a lot of money, but, you know, you can't just build it and editors will start showing up. You know, you got to be able to put yourself out there and realize that, you know, it's all on you. Every day when you wake up, and you're only going to work as much as, you know, you work. So
say one more time the resources you were talking about for people to learn how to do the various things that you do.
Yeah, NPPA is great. It's the National Press Photographers Association. They have some great resources. Their biggest thing on their site, which is a must-have for any photographer, is they have a calculator for the cost of doing business. And that's, you know, you can enter in all your bills, you know, what you pay for your house, what you want to make, how many days of a year you want to work, and it'll spit out a number. And it'll tell you, like, hey, you know, you should not be leaving the house for less than $400. You know?
Wow.
And, you know, yeah. But it's a reality check. You got to know, you know, you can't be going out and doing $100 gigs. You're not going to survive. You're paying your client to work at those rates.
You're going
into
debt. Right.
So there's that kind of those resources there. ASNP is a great is another site.
ASNP or ASNP?
MP.
M like mother.
Margaret.
Yeah, M as in Mary. And then Editorial Photographers is another one. You know, some great blogs, or like A Photo Editor is a great blog. And I always go to, like, the New York Times Lens blog and the Time Magazine Lightbox blog. New Yorker has a great one as well. That's more for inspiration. One person, if you really want to know business, John Harrington. He's a corporate photographer out of D.C., but his blog is full of business tips every day. And he's written the book, literally. There's two books, and it's got sample contracts, sample licensing breakdowns and things like that. So his site's great. You know, if you want more, I can put a link up on my site or something.
That would be great. I think
it has all these, like, listed out. So
yeah, that would be fantastic. If you don't mind, our viewers would love that, and we'll put a link in.
I can do a blog post. It might not be tomorrow. I got to shoot. Over maybe the next couple of days, I'll throw up a blog post that just has all these places. I mean, I'll just copy my bookmark list. And, you know, every day I'm like, boom, 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 seeing what's new, seeing what people are talking about, and really trying to, you know, educate myself every day, because there's always something new to learn. I mean, obviously, I don't know it. You know, I know like a tenth of what's out there, you know, information-wise. So I'm always trying to pick up new ways to either find clients or, you know, just sort of make my business better and more organized. So
now you're a confessed kind of social networking junkie. You're on many different sites.
Yes.
What advice would you give to be active yet still productive as you are? Clearly you go out and you shoot and you hustle work and you contact people, yet still find time to post to the internet to go on these beautiful shows that we have. I had mentioned I saw you on the photo shelter webinar, which was fantastic. So I'm just wondering, you know, do you have some advice to help people maintain balance with the social networking part of getting yourself out there and the actual getting out there and doing it?
Getting out there and shooting, or getting out there and making social media work?
Well, no, as far as getting out there and shooting or meeting or getting
being
yourself
productive.
Personally involved in the participation
of
work.
Yeah, by the way, another big resource, PDN, Photo District News, the magazine, great resource. They also have PDN EDU, is like they're doing a bunch of classes and training and stuff like that right now. So another place to go. As far as getting out there, you know, I always wake up and I have a to-do list, and my to-do list is not big. It's always small and very doable. You know, it's little things that I can do that day to sort of move myself forward every day. So at the end of the week, I've got a bunch of stuff done. If you look at one big to-do list, you're going to get overwhelmed, and you're like, I'm just going to sit here and stare at the screen and do Facebook all day, you know?
or take a nap.
Take a nap, exactly. I try to really kind of pick a couple things like, okay, look, I got to contact this magazine today, or I have to, you know, do this blog post, or, you know, whatever it is, or find one new client, you know, that kind of thing, to really keep myself motivated every day. But as far as, you know, getting out there, you know, I would say, you know, start some, you got to get some friends. I mean, if you're antisocial and you up and
but I have 262 friends, it tells me every day.
You know, I have a couple thousand, but you know, whatever, who's counting? I approve.
Hey, we all talk to those people.
That's right. Yeah. I approve everybody that comes into my Facebook. You know, and that's not because I'm trying to gain friends, but. You know, you never know where one relationship or one blog post is really going to, you know, snag somebody. And, you know, I forgot that I've had editors from places that I want to work following me. So, you know, one thing I would recommend for social media is, you know, do it a lot. Don't get addicted to it. But you got to keep it PG. you know, there's ways of, you know, bringing your own insecurities and your own, you know, issues, and don't talk politics, don't talk religion. You know, I really try to keep myself everything that I do, even on social media, even my Instagram. I'm not putting crappy photos of my cat, you know, and nothing against my cat, but I'm not trying to put those kind of pictures out there. I want everything that somebody sees related to Chip Litherland photography to be
the best chum ever. Yes.
Yeah, best chum ever. You know, I want it to be juicy and red and
red! Needs more red!
That's right. I want that blood to just... But, you know, I'm presenting myself on everything that I do in a way that I want people to see me. And, you know, the one time you mess up or you do something stupid or you say something wrong, and maybe not wrong, but, you know, just... inappropriate.
You gotta work real hard.
It's going to be around forever. And
you gotta
work
real hard. Yeah.
So everything I do is, you know, always comes back to, you know, not only growing my brand and my vision, but just, you know, trying to be a good person. And, you know, Sorry, I hope that answers somewhat. The other thing I would recommend for photography is, like I said earlier, go find something to shoot. You know, open up the paper, and if there's a cool event, like, oh my God, that would be great to just go shoot, go make pictures, you know, and you don't need a credential. You know, I shoot a lot of pro sports, you know, I shoot that kind of stuff, but you can go make pictures at high school games. You can go make pictures at Little League games. You can get out there and just find something to do, like the redneck, you know, the mud. That's from a self-assignment with one of my friends, you know, Saul Neelman, who covers weird sports. That's his entire thing. He travels the world and covers weird sports, from like pencil fighting to all this kind of random stuff.
Pencil fighting?
Yeah, no, like seriously, he has porta potty racing and all this really random stuff.
Oh my God. Karen, maybe he has that ferret in your pants game.
You know, you brought up that porta potty racing. I'm not going to lie when I tell you this. My hometown has those races every August. You have to decorate. They're called outhouse races. You have to decorate the outhouse. Somebody sits in the front and somebody pushes them along. And
see, that is the one time I would not be calling shotgun.
I would they took a picture of it. So, you know, that's the thing, you know. And I make self-assignments. And we went out and we covered the Redneck Games. That's what that picture's from. And, you know, it was like the best day of shooting of my life. And it wasn't because I was making pictures that I really was, you know, happy with, but I did like my pictures, but it was because I was, you know, with my friends and having fun and doing something new and different and experiencing life, getting away from this thing, you know. that's what it takes to be a photographer. You gotta turn this thing off, and nothing against your show, but you know, you got to go experience life through a lens. Look at that plug. You like that?
Yeah. That was a sweet ending to our show.
I know.
That was beautiful.
Yeah, no, we're just going to shut everything down.
Yeah.
Bye, everybody.
Well, we do have a few more questions from the chat, but I think please. We'll answer those maybe in the after show, or do we want to go a little bit longer?
We can go longer.
Okay.
Okay.
One of the questions is, how much of your work is about printing? How much of your work relies on printing?
Printing, like prints.
Or how heavily involved are you with the printing?
Mm-hmm.
I don't do it. I mean, I have resources. I have companies that I hire to do it for me. I don't even really own one, to be honest. I just hire the people that know how to do it better than me. And that's a big thing in, you know, business is hiring people. And, you know, if I don't know how to retouch something correctly, I'm going to hire somebody to go do that. And,
do you sell a lot of prints? Is a lot of your income stream prints?
No, not for weddings. I mean, I there's some printing after the fact, but I think people are more digital now. They just want files. They want to share, mm-hmm. you know, that kind of thing. I do fine art printing, and I'll sell people prints of my work just, you know, for fun and to do some limited edition prints. But as far as, you know, a lot of printing, no, I don't do a ton of it. Well,
okay. Another question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a favorite genre of all the genres that you shoot?
Yeah, probably photojournalism, and just because that just sprinkles through all my work. You know, that's you can do photojournalism at anything, and that's the easy way out of that answer. But you know,
it ties into the other question, which is when you walk around, are you thinking about what you want to shoot, or do you just see something and go click?
I'm thinking a lot, and it's. It's not. I'm not thinking about like, this would be the perfect picture right here if this were to happen. But I'm like, you know, I'm walking around, and you know, I'll see a wall or I'll see something, and really try to wait for that to develop. And you know, I'm constantly thinking of ways to kind of push the envelope. But I'm thinking of not only my editors or my boss or my commercial client in my head. You know, like I shoot for Legoland, Florida, and you know they have particular visions of things they need, and they need to be able to tell their story. So I have to have that in my head when I'm shooting. But for me, you know, they give me the liberty, and all my clients usually give me the liberty to, you know, hey Chip, go do your thing, and you know if it tells our story, then great. You know, and so you got to kind of balance with what you know what I like versus what they need. So, you know, as far as you know. The perfect picture, I'm not really seeking that out. I'm just seeking out fun pictures.
Except that one photo of, I guess it was like a crazy sunset and a bench. You're like, if only a person would just sit there.
Yeah, yeah, that's on my blog. Yeah, I keep a little Moleskine in my car notebook, and I write down intersections and walls and times of day, like 8:03 p.m. There's this really cool shaft of light. Go, you know, next time go out there and spend some time and wait for something. or just like a wall. They're like, oh, you know, like they're constantly painting walls in this town. So like, you know, one day there'll be a red wall, and next day there'll be a yellow wall, and there'll be some stupid mural. And you know, I'm constantly documenting these walls because someday I'm gonna make a picture there. The greatest day of my life was when there's a painting store right down the road, and they had white walls. And one day I turned the corner and they had painted it like a lifesaver. It was like a strip of red, strip of green, you know, purple. And I literally almost crashed my car because I was like, no, go. And the next engagement session I had, I was just like, boom, we're going. And we drove across town. They're like, where are we going? I'm like, just Trust me.
Just shut up. I'm a member to the madness.
I want to go to the beach. No.
In this day forward, I'm going to have a whole new vision of going and painting the town red.
That's right. People accuse me of carrying paint buckets in my car and Mennonites, of all things, because I apparently bring it.
One last question from the chat before we wrap this part of the program and start our second part. What do you think overall, the state of photojournalism today versus 10 or 20 years ago? You think it's better? Think it's worse? Something else?
Something else? I mean, I think it's different. I mean, I think technology is changing a lot. But there's still real issues and there's still real, stories out there, and everybody has a story to tell. Everybody's, interesting, and the economy is what it is, and wars are what they are, and there's always something to shoot. There's always something going on. There's always life happening, and I don't think, 20 years ago was like the heyday of photojournalism. Everybody says that, newspapers were well staffed, and magazines were sending photographers out for year-long assignments, and money was just everywhere. But today that's not happening, but they didn't have internet back then. So, pictures are more widely seen now. And technology is insane. Digital files are, I can't believe I'm going to say this, better than film. And, there's so much out there right now that it's just a different way of telling stories. So I don't think it's necessarily better or worse. I just think it's different. And, photojournalism will never die. I just think it's changing and it's evolving. And, if people let technology and all this other external stuff consume them, that's where the problem is. So, I think as long as everybody's sticking to hey, I want to make good pictures and tell stories and make art, then it's sweet.
Well, that's fantastic, Chip. I can't even say I'm like, wow, right out of my mouth.
Litherland.
Chip, it's been so. Chip, I'm gonna skip it. It's just. You have been illuminating on so many points. I've been watching the chat over here, which is part of my problem, is I get watching the chat, and everybody's just so fascinated with everything you have to say. You're just a wealth of information. Once again, your website is chiplitherland.com and 11weddings.com, the number 11weddings.com.
Or spelled out, actually, but either one works.
Either way.
Yeah.
Fantastic. That's how they can find you on the web. And we are going to continue the show in the after show. We're going to wrap the recorded part of the broadcast, restart this. So those of you in the chat, don't go away. We're going to do an on-one software giveaway. We are going to...
Are we doing a life plus one?
We're doing our life plus one in the after in the after show. So we have lots more. We're just going to do this in two parts. So we will be right back.
Right back.
Bye, you guys.